Hey, Deputy. You awake? You dozed off again. We're here. Come on, get out. We have a lot of work to do. Oh, this is... I hope you can hold your stomach, Deputy. Looks like whatever happened here didn't go well. Let's see what evidence we have. The first and most obvious, the scene we have in front of us. The victim's body has been nailed to the center of a pentagram, drawn from what appears to be their innards and that black substance we found in the disappearances. The symbols written on it translate to say, to die as just another nameless person instead of accepting our gift of peace. Well, whoever did this was sick, killing an innocent in their home. Let's see the face of the fallen man. Deputy, take a mental file. Victim was 24-year-old Miller Grain. Cause of death, currently unknown. Place of death, his home. Let's go looking around for clues to find the murderer. And put them 12 feet under. Found something, Deputy? What is... it? I think your resume lied about you being a rookie in the detective field. Because even with the years of training and work I have under my belt as a detective, I completely missed that round. By the looks of the round's head, it's from a rifle of some kind. Miller did have 3 different rifles, 2 for hunting and 1 for self-defense. This is a 7.62 NATO op round. Seeing as there are no bullet holes in the wall, the round must have hit the target. But seeing as there's no trace of blood, the target had to have been wearing Kevlar or something. But let's keep looking around. We are bound to find something. Okay, so, by the looks of things, the struggle started here. The intruder must have broken into his house, and hearing the sounds of his back door being unlocked, Miller must have took the offensive. He shot his op at the intruder, and, by my assumption, the intruder was wearing Kevlar, because there is no sign of foreign blood anywhere in here. Miller must have then been captured and killed over a bucket or container of some kind to prevent a messy scene, unless there's a room in the house that we haven't searched. And you can guess the rest. Still, not enough evidence to make a definitive case on what happened here, but we're getting closer. Fan out, Deputy. I'll take the attic, you get the basement. Got it? Good.
Our top story tonight. The burning of our local church. It was a large, popular church with the locals going there often for various activities. It served as a place of worship for other foreign religions, as one might guess a church to be. Local authorities say that this was not an accident after finding strange markings in the sacrament room, as well as the burned ashes of the Bibles in the library section of the church being spread to say, There is no god anymore. He is not what you make him out to be. Could this be a direct attack against someone or any religious group? A threat from a cult? We may never know. Now, moving on to...
Deputy, you find anything? No? Then what was that all about? Because that was news from a different state entirely. And there are more VHS tapes with different state names on them. Now, that raises an even bigger question. How did these get here? From what our file on Miller says, he was born in this state and never left it. Not even for vacation. So, unless he lied about leaving, I have to make one of my assumptions to be that this is a setup by someone to frame someone else. But who? And why? Oh, the attic? Just some old records, a tarot card set, and a Tripitaka with some of its pages torn out. Just strange stuff. Alright, so, with what we have gathered, we need to make a guess on what happened here to pin it on our board of evidence. Gabriel or Haro were responsible for this, given Trene was found deceased with a tape on him saying his crimes. None of which involved this case we are on, so he's ruled out. So, what we can take from this case? His murder wasn't reported until around 9:27 p.m., and from what our medical professionals say, he died around 8:12 p.m. So, it was an hour or so after his death it was reported. By the way this murder was, the intruder must have broken in when Miller was trying to sleep. He heard the lock being broken and took the offense with his op, like I stated earlier. He fired one round in his bedroom that ended up two more rooms down in his guest bedroom. We don't know if the round hit or not, but it likely did. The killer then got in close quarters with him, knocking him out cold with blunt force trauma. But that is just from observation. After he was knocked out, upon closer examination of his body, his throat was slit and used to fill something. He was then gutted, and his insides, along with that black substance that we've encountered before, was used to paint a pentagram that Miller's body was then nailed to the center of. Using the rest of the black substance, they wrote that quote. No other evidence has been found. Come on, deputy. Let's get back to the station. We have a lot of writing to do. That painting in the corner. How did we miss that on our first sweep through the house? It's titled Miller the Killer. Deputy, we're heading back and filing this report. Case number 20,424. Victim, Miller Grain. Age, 24 years old. Unofficial cause of death, blood loss via slit throat. Place of death, his home. Miller Grain was a veteran from the Cold War. Loved in this community for his oftentimes over-exaggerated stories and jokes. A fan favorite among children. He was also an avid hunter, and the community loved him for that. Criminal record, he was caught drinking and driving on two accounts. Had his license suspended for 2 years, was imprisoned on charges of property damage and noise disturbances. In his home was another art piece titled Miller the Killer. The drawing depicted what we assume to be a demented version of Miller grabbing the arm of a child with one hand while stabbing them with a spike in his other arm. The child is depicted screaming and crying, but most disturbingly of all, the child appears similar to the little girl the Walton family had coincidentally, 3 years after Hara's pronounced death, was found dead in her bed, a massive hole in her chest, like she had been impaled. This killer is so much more sick than Haro. But if it is Haro behind this, I wouldn't put it past him. Years of being forgotten can give someone time to become worse than ever. Back to the case. There seems to be patterns almost in each of these cases. Each victim had a criminal record of some kind. All except for the case of Yarumada. He had no criminal record, but that begs the question. Who is behind all of this? What do they want? What is the motive? Are they taking or killing the victims for their own selfish gain or sick view of justice? Whatever is going down, I will solve it. And the person causing all of this pain and suffering will face justice, no matter what.
He will pay. They will pay. You will pay.
Hey guys, Scratch here. This script was a pain, but we got through it, it works, it's perfectly fine, and it's coherent. That's nice to say. Anyway, I now have a confirmed number of episodes that this will have. I'm not going to say it, but I now know how many there will be. And it seems like this is heading in a very interesting direction. I am very excited to read the next script. Thank you, TPA, for writing this, by the way. Thank you, TPA, so much. Always make sure to credit the script writers. But yeah, if you like this video, like, comment, subscribe. I love Enchanter with comments. And you made it this far, so why not subscribe? Join the Patreon and the Discord. And yeah. Bye-bye.